Amen. Come on, let's give it up for Jesus right about now. Come on. Truly honored to be here tonight. I don't know if they want me to stand still, but I feel like walking around, Jesus. Woo! I'm so honored to be here in the presence of the Lord and want to give him all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. He deserves it. Amen. Honor to Apostle Steve and Michelle. What a beautiful man and woman of God. I met lots of people in my time, but they are truly beautiful. I appreciate you so much. I am truly honored here to be here on the kickoff night of something new. I believe God is doing something new. I believe if you come expecting something new, you're going to get it. Amen. Amen. You like those big smorgasbords? We can go get you what you want. A little bit of chicken up in here, a little bit, you know, a little bit of Cajun shrimp, a little Jamaican flavor. Come on, everything's going to be all right, man. You know what I'm saying? It's going to come on like that. I was starting to feel it coming across the floor, just like that. I was starting to feel a Cajun coming up. It's coming up down in the islands. I was coming at night in time, yeah? Woo. I let my brothers with the little thing that they do over here, like this. You know, they get the praise on, you know. You know what I mean? Just like, you know, God made you unique for his purpose. Amen. Amen. You got to get comfortable in your own skin if you're going to praise God. And you can't worry about anybody else when you close your eyes and put your hands up. It doesn't matter. You like to sing on key. Come on, you're gonna stay with me here tonight, aren't you? I like the music and the praise. But listen, if you give a praise unto God from your heart, he will receive it, and he will bless you for it. I think that sometimes we forget how good God is. We hear about it all the time, don't we? We hear about it, the goodness of God. We hear about God's gonna do something new. We go, yeah, like what? Now he's gonna pay my bills? Huh? He's gonna take care of my family? He's gonna do this? Yes, he's gonna do that. I think sometimes we think God is so small that that's all he can do. We're asking him for something too small. And tonight I'm asking you to get your expectation out there for God to do something big for you. Something he's never done for you. Something that's not just doesn't come one time, but it's a continual flow. Jesus said, I'm the living water. He's a continual flow. And I thank God for his mercy that he doesn't give us what we deserve. That we've been recreated in Christ Jesus and for good works in him. I thank God that he gave some to be apostles. I feel so honored to be here tonight. I'm just looking around. Woo, I just had the time right now by myself. I can see you off of here. Amen. I mean, just think about it. Gave apostles, gave prophets, pastors and teachers, huh? Evangelists for the good news of who Jesus is. Woo, it's just, you know, it's just let it flow. Sometimes we get caught up in our head thinking about how we're going to do it, how we're going to do it, how we're going to do it. What's got to be done? What's got to be done? Hey, listen, I had a challenging week just like you all did. I had a week where it just wasn't stopping. Trying to figure it all out, all the logistics, where the car's going to be, who's driving my different cars. I have three sons. They're all driving. Huh? My wife takes her own car and tells you, you work it out, honey. Huh? Oh, I married a long time. I said, yes, ma'am. See, that's what you say to that. You know, stay married, glory to God. Yes, ma'am, honey. I got myself an Italian stallion. Glory to God. Woo! I can still see you out there. Those lights on. Come on. I got myself an Italian stallion. I said, dear God, it was on my list of something. I want a woman who can cook for me. Glory to God. Woo! Because I can eat. So if I can eat, I want some woman who can really cook. She said, I don't know how to cook. I said, don't worry. Just keep trying. It'll work out. It's in your blood. Your grandma could do it. Your mama could do it. You can do it. Don't mess with my face. I believe you can cook. I'll tell you a little funny story before we get started. I like to go around and touch on the people because Jesus loves people. You know, you can't keep me in this game without Jesus loving people. You know, it's too hard to do something in your strength. It's too hard to get through stuff in the natural. It's too hard to get through when your mind can't figure it out. But Jesus can come in on a situation and change something in a moment. And he can come in here and love on somebody that you don't even like that person. But you can love him in his name. Amen. He said, if my name is lifted up, I'll draw all men to myself. Woo, I feel the preaching here tonight. If you can't preach in here, your wood is wet. My God, I feel the preaching here. Woo, my body's going in different directions. Woo, I feel it right now. Listen, I came to declare the good news that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead, just like he said. He came and he said, go and tarry 50 days. The Jews call it the time of weeks. We call it Pentecost. He said, then the Holy Spirit will come upon you. He said, they had no idea how this was going to happen. But because he said it, they said, okay, Lord. They said, we're struggling with what you told us. But okay, Lord. Peter said, you know, we fished all night. We're fishermen. I'm from a fisherman family. My father's house is right there on the lake. There's our business right there. There's our boats right there. We washed it. We fished all night, caught nothing. Jesus was cooking up a little meal for them. He said, cast your nets on the other side. It's time to bring in a great catch. I'm prophesying to you now. It's time to bring in a great catch. I'm here to tell you, you've been fishing in the shallows too long. You've been looking for the fish you catch, pay your light bill, and take care of this, and what about this one, and what about that one? None of those prayers are wrong. God honors it. God is saying, start seeing me big. Come on, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I feel like walking around up in here. Come on over. You know, let us exalt his name together. Let's lift him up. Huh? You know, there's been a lot of fluff going on in the body of Christ. I've been around ministry and the families in ministry my whole life. My father's father was a pastor. My father's brother was a pastor. My mom and dad were on the expansion church on the board. My dad was the treasurer for like 30 years. My mom taught Sunday school. My mom said, if you love Jesus, and you can love other people, if you can forgive people, keep in right relationship with them, God will move through your life. It'll change the world, won't it? Mother Doris right there. Thank God she's right here. I love it when the mama's in the house. Watch out, now I can find a woman. Where's that mama in the house? Right there. Woo! Gotta come over there. Get some. Amen. Amen. So let's do what we do at my house. Isaiah heard God this way. He said, Lord, I want to see your glory. Amen. I like it when a story has a preamble, has a premise, and God is stirring something in us that messes with our insides and bypasses our minds, all the things we've been thinking. And God begins to stir us from the inside and grab us from that place where he saved us. And it's not, there's no fluff in it. There's no fluff in it. It's all substance. It's all, gets you on the inside. Goes, and we grab the kids, you know, you just shake them. You see the little kids, and they're so cute, just want to shake them. It gets you from the inside. And he says, I'm about to renew your spirit and refresh you in my presence. And you're going to stop worrying about everything you've been worried about. Stop struggling with that. Listen, there's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Don't go there. Don't condemn yourself. It won't make any better. You've been called to liberty in Christ Jesus. He who did not spare his own son, but freely gave him for us all. Will he not with him give us all things? Amen. Woo! Substance. Glory to God. I feel the presence of the Lord in here in a strange and marvelous way. I am honored. I am privileged. I'm inspired. Some people look on this little chart here and they say, does he know where he's at? Hey, who is that white bread up in here? What's going on with that right there? Yeah? Let me tell you a little story. That boy better have some preaching up. Amen. Listen, it's not about who I am. It's about who Jesus is. You know, I remember my mother teaching me in Sunday school when I was a little boy. The first song I remember hearing, it said, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loved the little children of the world. That's the first thing I remember. So Jesus loved everybody. Red and yellow, black and white, every socioeconomic group, wherever you've been from, Jesus is right there for you. He's right there for me. Listen, if my brother right here, come here, brother. If my brother right here needs a blood transfusion and my blood matched the blood that he needed, I could go give him some of my blood and put it in his veins and it could save his life. We ought to get the wisdom of the Lord in that deal, amen? You know, God's, while this stuff is stirring in the world and while things, they're saying it's getting worse and there's, you know, there's cop killers and there's more segregation and all this stuff is going on. Well, there's an evil report. God has a good report. And his report goes like this, red and yellow, black and white. They are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Amen. Listen, you can't fake it till you make it. You either love somebody or they know you don't. They know whether you love them or not. I know whether you love me or not. Because it's spiritually discerned. Amen. Your spirit, to His spirit, to my spirit, knows if we love each other as sons of God. He said, another spirit I give. Stay with me. Another spirit I give you. See, it's the spirit of sonship where we cry, Abba, Father.
Amen.
Amen. Well, we're not worried about ourselves and this one over here and what's going on over there, but we're crying, Father, Father. And He's crying, Father, Father. And when we cry together, Father, Father, we are in the unity of the Spirit, okay, and in the bond of peace because we are calling on Him as sons.
Amen.
Amen. So, man, I'm excited. Hallelujah. In the midst of trouble, God is working.
Yes.
Thank you, brother.
Praise God.
Amen. So, get some water right here. I'd like to know where my people at. You know what I'm saying? I was in North Plainfield. Where my Jersey people at? Come on, some Jersey in the house. Somebody right there. I know there's always somebody from Jersey in there. Come on. Right? New York. Come on, brother. Jersey too. Jersey too. You gotta get a jersey?
Live in Jersey.
Live in Jersey. Yeah. Minister in New York, don't you?
Right.
Amen. God, listen. Listen.
Bless the Lord.
Listen. Yeah, see, I want to see if he said yeah yet. Yeah. See, if we don't acknowledge. See, this is how God gets us. He goes, hey, Steve, listen. We go, yeah, but I got to. He goes, no. Listen.
Yes.
And then we go, okay, be still and know that I'm God, right?
Come on.
And so when I went in, I want to see if he's going to. See, it's not about me. It's about what God's trying to do for him. Amen. Is it all right? This flow, is that all right, Pastor? Listen. You have prayed some prayers that you have not seen answered yet. That's no mystery. Let's go deeper. Okay, but you prayed some crazy prayers in a secret place that only God could answer.
My God.
And you begin to get in that place and say, God, am I praying a crazy prayer or should I pray a different prayer? I prayed the same prayer so long, I'm either going to see it with my eyes before I see you, or I'll pray something else. So you started getting provoked about it. Okay, in a good way. And you said, Lord, should I keep praying this prayer? He said, keep praying that prayer. He said, when I answer it, it's going to be in suddenness. It's going to be this person here and that person there. God does things in connection. Okay? When God's going to bless you, He brings a person in your life. When God wants you to bless somebody, He brings a person to you and says, here's what I want you to do, Pastor Wong. God's great, great things for you, great influence. You're able to break through barriers others not have not been able to. Listen, you haven't even hit your stride yet. Age had nothing to do with it. It's all about walking out the plan, the purpose of God. God's got great things for you. Listen, He's got things that would surprise you. Listen, because you got a crazy imagination. Okay, you can imagine some crazy thing. Even people say, man, I don't know, he's just crazy. He just like that. No. Listen, he's crazy. He's an anointed crazy to believe God for things that no one else will believe for. And it's because you can, God will reward you for it. He said, without faith, it's impossible, but with faith, it's all possible with God. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.
Where's my brother over here? Man, when I get to heaven, I'm going to have a voice like his. Woo, glory to God. Where's my brother? I bet you heard me. Man, I'm in that voice like down here somewhere, down like low F. Everything going to come out in that note right there. I'm going to put my man pants on and walk around heaven. Bless God. I'm going to walk, you know, with my deep voice. I'm just going to walk around up in there. Amen. Would it be all right if I minister something to you? I want to hit this so early. I'm so excited. When I came down and sat down here tonight, I looked over at you and your wife. Is it Michael and Tony?
Mike and Tony.
Mike and Tony, yeah. Mike and Tony. And, you know, you got a crazy Spanish name going on with the back. I bet you heard that a few times. You're like, man, they didn't expect that, did they? You know? But God is bringing you into a time of fulfillment. You have labored a long time. You have prayed. You have been at different stations. You've been at CTN and TV and all these different places. You've met all these people. You know all kinds of famous people, and they recognize you by face and go, yep, that's Mike and Tony right there. Now, we've never met before. We've never talked before. But when I sat down there tonight, the Lord said, I'm bringing them to a place of fulfillment and completion. Things that were unfinished in another season. Things that could not have been done. So don't worry about, you know, how far you came with it. The fact is you persevered under trial. You believe when, what was the budget? You know, hey, and you're like, listen, if we believe for that crazy budget when it was totally impossible, why can't we believe for the budget now? See, so it isn't. God says if you roll all your cares upon him, he says like casting the nets, cast your cares on him. He cares for you. You know this. But it's about doing it in the present tense. You know, when I studied Greek in college, there's something called the present perfect tense. It's ongoing in the moment you do it, and then it's over and you need to do it again. So it's not about not completing it, it's about stepping into it and then stepping into it, like one foot in front of the other. And that's all you have to do in this season. God's going to give you a time of completion, a time of favor, a time of fulfillment is what I'm hearing. And those people who, you thought, man, if just a few of those people who we know some famous people, and if they would just come and bless our life and say, you know what, my ministry's blessed, let me get that big ledger checkbook out, you know, put some zeros next to a number, we could do some things, and then we could do it again. And you've been looking for seed in all different kinds of places because you're sowers. Is this all right? And God is saying, I'm pleased with your sowing. And he said, it's only been a little while, but it seems like it's been a long time. But he says that, I hear the scripture where he says, don't be weary in well-doing. Because in due season, he said, it's not wrong to be weary, just don't be weary in well-doing. Because you're going to reap a harvest if you're not weary of doing it well. See that? How God will take a turn of phrase. He'll take the scripture and go, you know, here's how it is. And he'll drop it on you like that. So it's all about him building his kingdom in the hearts of men. Amen? So God's got so many more lives to touch. Even coming here tonight. You know, you had so much going on this week. There are other places you could have been. I heard your wife talking to you on the way here. Is that right? I didn't say what it was, but I did hear it. All right? Just say, you know, when I got to that part, you knew. He's like, I hope he doesn't say all that we talked about. No, I won't. But I only know a little bit. So, but the thing is that the Holy Spirit's a gentleman. And I love that if God's going to do great things through you, that he's humble, but he's powerful. That's the spirit that's on the two of you. Would you mind standing for a moment? All right? Where are my people? Where's Pastor Carolyn? And yeah, here she is. Come on. I need another gentleman. Well, give me whoever you have. Yeah, give me the people. All right, come on up here for a minute. This is a special night for you. You had no idea you'd be honored tonight, did you? You know, you're like, man, if people gave us the things they promised us, how set would you be today? Yeah, you'd be really set, right? Over the top, thank you, Jesus set, right? So tonight, this is a new night. Stretch your hand out towards this beautiful couple right here. This is a new night for you. This is a new day, a day of completion, a day of fulfillment, a day where the Lord himself stands up strong and mighty. It's not about what you do. It's not about what you have done. It's not about taking another account of, you know, did we do enough and was it enough? It's about saying, you know, give me that little boy's lunch and I'm going to put it in your hands. It's going to multiply. You feed people with what he gives you and it's going to multiply. Stop looking for seed. All around, just say, Lord, whatever you say, I'll do it. Just like the wedding of Cana, whatever you say. And then enter into the rest of the Lord. There is a Sabbath rest for the people of God. You know, get onto the spot where the glory comes out. You know how to flow in the Spirit. You know how to receive from the Lord. And get away. The more pressure that's on you to produce, the more you need to get away and get alone. And see, and then times of refreshing come in the presence of God. So, Father, I bless them now, Mike and Tony. Lord, I thank you for your servants here. What a privilege. What a privilege, Lord. Lord, they've labored long. They've labored hard. They've done lots of things for you. And Lord, you said that what they will do in secret, you would reward them openly. Father, open up and expand this territory in West Palm Beach. You sent them here. You would never send them here without supply. You would never send them out here without people. You would never send them out here with whatever they needed. If they needed a new car, a better house, a new word, whatever it is, you know, kindreds, peoples, tribes, you know, spiritual things, natural things. You would never have sent them here without supply. Lord, bring in new refreshing supplies as they rest in you in the Sabbath of God. Bring it in. Bring in people where they can recognize, hey, you're our kind of people. We're going to hang out with you. And there's other people, we love them, but we don't like them. It's all right. You know, we're going to fellowship with people again. We're going to love and relax and have some food that we like to go. We're going to go where we want to eat. And we don't care who pays for it. We're just going to go and do what we do and let Jesus be glorified. Amen. We give you praise, Lord, right now. Father, a fresh anointing is all right to fight. Father, right now, a fresh anointing on my brother. A fresh and a refreshing, a refreshing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Like rain coming down from heaven, so shall my word be. It will not return to me void. It shall accomplish that which I've sent it to do. So rest, my son. Rest, my daughter. It's your time. It's your time to enter into the Sabbath of God and see what I'm going to do. When you rest, I'll work. When you rest, I'll work. You're saying we can't do any more than we're doing. We're pretty stretched out. A little conversation on the way over here. Look, are we supposed to really be here? Because we got to know it's God to be here. Because if it's not, we should be somewhere else. Or home taking a nap or something. Go out to eat and just kiss your face or something, right? But, you know. I feel it, you know, right there. Glory to God. Lord, let there be refreshing in your presence, Lord. Here you go. Oh, here it is. Yes. Pastor Carolyn, would you touch on the, you know, I'm real respectful of these things. Put your hand on her forehead right here. Sir, is that all right, sir? All right, here we go. A little refreshing, Lord. Here he comes. People of God, it's interactive. Worship God, pray, speak in tongues. Come on now. Thank you, Lord. Refresh. Yeah, there it is. There's a willingness to let it go. There's a willingness to get that weight off and said, I'm just going to stop being weary and enter to the rest of God. God's going to bring me this stuff. He sent me here. I will declare the Lord. He is my rock, my refuge, the fortress, the God in whom I trust. A refreshing. Here it comes. A refreshing. Hallelujah. Give God some praise. Come on. Don't you love Jesus? I do. You know, I like when he said that aside from me, you can do nothing. That pretty much sum it up. So you're going to come in your own stuff. You aren't going to be there long. Jesus will come up and supersede you and say, you know what? You were driving too slow. I'm about to get out ahead of you and do something. Woo! Glory to God. I get excited about the thing. Where's my guy on the keyboard? Give me some little something. Give me some little, huh? Yeah. Otherwise, I have to sing Ebony and Ivory up in here. You know? Hey, I like a guy with a crazy sense of humor. Come here, brother. I gotta finish walking with you again. Let me come here. Come walk with me. Walk with me. Hey, the joy of the Lord. It's your strength. Listen, you got a crazy sense of humor. It is flat out nuts. I feel the presence of the Lord, my brother. Hey, I see times of joy. I see where your joy is overflowing. Listen, you don't even hear your stuff. You've done something. You're a man of God, respected, known in places. But let me tell you something. If he be lifted up, he'll draw. Just lift him up. And you say, he's anointed your head with joy. The oil of joy. That's your ministry. Look, you can do all this other stuff. You can preach and pray about it. You can pray for people. Do it. But joy is the target of your ministry. You know, it is your purpose when you were dedicated when you were a little child. You were dedicated to the Lord. Joy. You used to laugh as a little baby. I could God's taking me back in time. I hear like little video clips. You know, and he would put the thing, change the clothes, take a little anything, laugh. Crazy, right? Oh, everything made him laugh. It was funny. People would just do stuff to him and make him laugh. And why do we get grown up all serious? All like, oh God, I got things to face. I got things to do. And life is hard. But look, Jesus. No, joy. The oil of joy. He said, He said, therefore I will satisfy you with living water and wells of salvation and wells of joy. Will flood your soul. Wells of joy will flood your soul. You're going to be a holy bubbler to the people where you are from that place. It's going to go out like a rock underwater, and it's going to go out and out and out. And you're not going to have to work at this anymore. And see, you're not going to have to trabajo at this anymore. You're not going to have to travail in a way that you just think, well, I just need to do it like this. But you're going to get in the presence of the Lord, and joy is going to flood your soul. And you're going to go get that joy and all the people who are weighted down with problems and weighted down with worries and, you know, trying to figure it out. And you're going to say, don't worry, Jesus can handle it. Take some of this joy. You're anointed for joy, my brother. You're anointed for joy. You're anointed from this day forward. You know what a memorial stone is, right? You're going to put down a memorial stone and say, from this day, the last, you know, day of October, before we go to November, 5776 in Jewish calendar. Amen? That's where you're at, right? After Passover, after Pentecost, after Tabernacles, Rosh Hashanah, you're in the year of Jubilee, which is a year of joy. It's a 50th year. You'll never see one like this in your lifetime again. It's a year of Jubilee, not just the beginning of the day. It is a year. So you've got a lot of time to be filled with joy. I see the Lord bringing you places that He brings you in, and it changes the atmosphere while you're bringing Jesus with you. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the power is of God and not of us. It's Him working in us to will and to do of His good pleasure. Amen. It's not us working us. It's not us working Him. It's Him working us. And we're just saying, we're just coming as sons and saying, Father, whatever you want to do, let's do it. Joy, joy, joy. Where's my brother Jersey? Okay. My Jersey brother, hey, let's just speak into that for a minute. Is this all right? I need some water. Man. Here we go. Do you get water too? Here, hang on to this. All right. Listen, you're going to employ people in the kingdom of God. Listen, God's anointed you for business too, other things too. There's a bunch of things right here. But the joy is the target. Come after the Lord. Say, Lord, you're my joy, my salvation. You're my rock and refuge, the God in whom I trust. Anointed with joy. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Father, give them a refreshing right now. Come on, everybody pray. Speak it. I like an employed body of Christ. I like an employed fivefold ministries. Come on. Hey, speak it. Declare it. Joy. 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 Hallelujah. Well, let him rest. Let him rest, God. Hallelujah. Man, where to start tonight? Where to start tonight? Ooh, joy. 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 I got the joy, 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 joy. Wait, down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I got the joy, 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 joy. Down in my heart. But it's not down in my heart to stay. Because I got the love of Jesus. Love of Jesus. Down in my heart. Can I have this? Is this your husband right here, man? Is this your husband? Yeah, can you two come out for a minute? I'm going to say what I was going to say. Like the song says, say what you need to say. Listen, there's a time to be quiet. There's a time to say something. Huh? Every parent knows that one. Every husband, every wife, glory to God. What's your name? Joy. Yeah, and? Joy and Louie. I like it. That's like a New York, New Jersey name. Louie. I like that. It's like, hey, Louie. Come here, I gotta tell you something. Got a thing to tell you. My friend, he's got a little place down the street. You know what it is? They make bread. And I mean, they put like stuff in it so we can smell the stuff in the street. A little garlic comes out. Different kinds of smells come out of his bakery. If you go down there and eat his bread, you'll never be hungry again. You know what I'm talking about, Louie? Amen, amen. I like how he said, amen, amen. I like that. Amen. I like that. See, because he's authentically himself. Listen, the Lord began to work in your life in such a way, it freaked him out, right? But God began to do a thing in you that you begin to recognize. And he was like, am I going to end up with a woman that I know, or am I going to end up with someone else? See, that's the fear. And so, you know, God always does the perfect work, but he blesses those who trust him. And so you're on this journey together. You're not doing anything wrong, Louie. Don't worry. Well, I could still, you know. But listen, you know. Come on. You know. But listen, you know. Listen. Don't worry about it. You know how they say, don't worry about it? Don't worry about it. It's going to be all right. See, when God does a work from the source, Him who created all things, sustains all things by the power of His word. And so when God does it, He does it right the first time. What do we have to do? Jesus will say to the disciples, I'm going to pray to the Father. And he's going to send. I'm going up to pray. What was he doing? He's going to receive what the Father had in mind. And he knew that God, he trusted God implicitly, had everything done perfect. So even when you don't know how to trust him, just trust him anyhow, and he'll reward you for it. You get rewarded, you come back and do it again. Like the bakery down the street where you like the bread or whatever it is, or you like the money, whatever you like. Whatever you like. You know, God is going, I know what you like, because I made you. I hear Psalm 137, 138, fearfully and wonderfully made. Awesomely made. God took and formed you before you in your mother's womb, before you had a thought, before you thought, this is what I'm going to do. You're kind of a guy, this is what I'm going to do. You're kind of like resolved in whatever you're going to do. It's all like this, all resolved. Amen? And it's like you're thinking, wait a minute now. I signed up for what I have known. I don't know what this is going to turn out like. This is like baking a cake. You don't know where it's going to end up. Right? But he said, but God does everything perfect in his time. Ecclesiastes 3 says there's a time and season under heaven for everything. You know, a time to rejoice, a time to weep, a time for life, a time to death, where you're able to embrace the season and what God has done. And so, you know, God is working in you, and he's working in her at different speeds, okay? It's like having two different cars. It's okay. Drive your speed, she'll drive her speed. But don't worry. Have faith in God. He can bring it all about. He can, according to his purpose. What he does is he draws you together. He draws you together unto himself. And you can come in your time, and she can come in her time, but you end up there the same time. God has a supernatural synergy like that. So I want to just encourage you tonight that God has it all under control. And not to worry, you know? You know what you like. You know what you want to do. But God made you. Before the foundation, he knew you. He separated you, put you up. And he said, okay, Louie, it's you and me. Let's go. Let's go. It's pretty straightforward like you are. He can talk to you like that. He knows how to talk to you. He knows how you want to hear it. Right? He got like a little swagger with his thing. He got a little bobbing and weaving. You know what I mean? He's got a little something going on. Yeah. But listen, he's at ease with himself like you. You're like, I know me. I know that. But what about this? Hey, nothing wrong with that. At least you know who you are. You know, that's good, good, good. Listen, God is doing something in her. Just stand back and see it. Just stand back and look at it. Embrace it. Say, I love you. I'm for you. I was then, I am now. Let God do his work of salvation. Let him do it in you. Yeah, just need it. Don't worry about it. And say, God, I love her. She loves me. I hope she loves me after this is all done, right? Yeah, see, now I'm getting, see, I was so polite and everything like that. I was so nice, right? But it's all going to be all right because she loved you from the beginning. She didn't love you for someone else. She knew what she had in you. So she loved you anyhow, you know, and you love her for what you love her. So God's not going to mess that up and say, okay, now, you know, now this is all messed up because she's growing in God and I don't know if I'm, you know, he's not confused. He's not worried, okay? But God has faith in himself. I like how the scripture says he stands on his word to perform it. He stands on his word. He gets on that word, he stands on it, and then he performs it. So he's not worried. He's not wringing his hands. He's not trying to figure things out. He's just standing on it and performing it and performing it. Father, we thank you right now for Louie. We thank you right now for joy. Lord, we say that there is joy in your presence. Lord, there's everlasting joy. Lord, in your right hand, Lord, that you put them in your right hand and no one can take them out of you. Lord, we thank you that Louis is coming with you. He's coming in his way. He's coming in his time. But Lord, you're receiving it. Lord, you're saying, Lord, I can walk whatever speed you're comfortable with. Let's do it. If you want to run, I can do that too. Whatever you want to do. And he's taking you where you're at from the inside out. Father, I thank you there's no worry in your presence. I thank you there's only faith. I thank you there's only love. And there's only joy. There's righteousness. There's peace in the Holy Ghost. And Father, be a refreshing in your presence right now. That you would refresh them and touch them, Lord, with your presence, Lord. A fresh anointing, a fresh resolve to trust you, to rest in your presence, to rest in your love. We thank you for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Give God some praise now. Amen. If you got your Bibles with you tonight, amen. Let's start with the beginning. Genesis 1, 14. Open your Bible to Genesis 1. This is what God said. This is what God said. You know, something he spoke to me about recently, he said, you know, before I worked, I rested. And you should too, Steve. Yeah. I said, yeah, my tendencies keep going. My tendency is to do what's in front of me to do. Right? But God said, if I rested, and then I work, that's what you should do. I said, okay, sir. I said, show me. He said, it's in Genesis. He said, I spoke into the darkness and into confusion. I said, light be. But before that, I was resting. Now, I was not sleeping. I was cognitive of the fact of what I was preponderating to do. I was thinking about it. I was imagining what the earth should be. How it should be formed, what should be in it. And you always start with, and God spoke and it was, and before I spoke, I rested. He said, I've always done 7-day cycles. 7-day cycles. And he said, so 7 days is a Shemitah, and on a 50th 7-day cycle, it's a Jubilee, which is where we are right now. We come through tabernacles. We're in the Moedim, we're in established time. It's just a Hebrew word for an established time. And God has set it apart for his purpose. And if you know what to do with it, you can have what it says you can have. You can be who God says you can be. you can do what God says you can do, and you get reintroduced to yourself and your identity and purpose in this season. Amen. So Genesis 1:14 says that he sent in the firmament, he sent light into the midst of the darkness. It says he separated the light from the dark, and he set out two lights, the sun and the moon. And he said, this is, I'm going to do in perpetuity, and I'm calling it times, seasons, days, and years. And so we've just come through a time where there's been a lot of publicity about the four blood moons. You know, you see it in Acts chapter 2, you see it in the book of Joel. You know, light and darkness, and you see that the moon was covered as if it was in blood. The sun had been darkened. The timings and seasons of God. God says, I'm setting out times and I'm signing from the heavens so everybody can see it. And everybody, if they can see it and perceive what I'm doing, they can have what I'm saying and doing. And so God, it isn't some mystical thing. It's not some strange thing. It's something God has set in order and in time. And you and I live in that time right now. You know, it's for times, seasons, signs. If you don't know, like the master key, you can't figure out what he's doing. Now, you can discern it by the Spirit, right? But if you know that he said it in Genesis and then begin to count off, God is right on time about everything. And the thing that one of the major things the enemy attacks us about is this thing where I was believing God, but it didn't come in on time. Or I thought it was going to be like this, and God did it like this. And so the struggle happens in our faith to believe when things don't happen the way we expected them to. Because God doesn't disappoint us and set out an expectation that he doesn't meet. Are you with me? Amen. We're going somewhere. Yes. Going somewhere in the smorgasbord line. Amen. Yeah, that's what he does. Open with me 2 Chronicles chapter 6. I'm going to show you something I never heard preached. Because I never preached, I've never heard it. But God opened up, he said, tell me where it says this. And I like to study the word because in it is life. It is life to you, health to your flesh. Amen. Are you enjoying this tonight so far? Man, now we're having a time of fellowship and worship and the Spirit of God moving in our midst. Lord, we give him all the praise and the glory. And so here's what's happening in 2 Chronicles 6. Look at verse 40 with me. Now, my God, it says, may your eyes be open and your ears be attentive to the prayers offered in this place. Now arise, O God, and come to your resting place, you and the ark of your might. May your priests, O Lord God, be clothed with salvation. May your saints rejoice in your goodness. O Lord God, do not reject your anointed one. Remember the great love promised to David, your servant. He's talking covenant here. He's saying, God, you made a covenant, and you got to keep it. See, now God isn't held over a barrel by anybody, but he always recognizes his blood covenant. Amen. When you call on God based on his covenant, you've got his attention. You want to get God's attention? You just talk to him about his covenant. Amen. And so, yeah, could you open this for me? Thank you. And so this happened, the statement. Thank you, sir. This happened right before the dedication of the temple. You can leave that right there. Thank you. And then Solomon finished praying, and fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests could not enter the temple because the Lord's glory had filled it. And when the Israelites saw the fire coming down and the glory of the Lord above the temple, they knelt on the pavement with their faces to the ground and worshiped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, I like this thing about the Jewish people, every jot, every tittle. You know, Gentiles, speed read. I already know that, so let me get to the part that I'm going. But not Jews, every jot, every tittle. What did he say? He said, they got on their faces and worshiped the Lord, saying, he is good and his love endures forever. He is good and his love endures forever. He is good and his love endures forever. You want to get God's attention? Get on your face and say, he is good and his love endures forever. Not my will, not my works, not what about this, what about that. Now, Lord, I've been waiting a long time, don't you know? Listen, he'll listen to all that like a benevolent parent. And then you go, hey, are you done yet? Hey, are you done yet? You done crying about it? Pitying yourself and all that stuff? Pick yourself up and stand and see the salvation of God. And then when you stand, you'll do like Isaiah did. Whoa, I got to get down on the altar now because the Lord has come in this place. And I'm saying he's good and his mercy endures forever. He's good and his mercy endures forever. He's good and his mercy endures forever. There are times of refreshing in the presence of the Lord. There are times of refreshing in the presence of the Lord. It isn't fluff, it isn't hype, it's substance. There is times of refreshing in the presence of the Lord. God has enabled and equipped you for every work that he's called you to. The thing isn't to try to keep figuring it all out. The thing is to find out what you're equipped to do and go do it. Amen. You don't have to worry about the results. You just do the work that he sent you to do. Come on, somebody. You do the work he sent you to do. Forget about rolling around it. Forget about crying on the floor about it. You say, man, I look like one of my kids and crying, Mom, he didn't feed me tonight. He didn't do this tonight. And you think, man, this is embarrassing. God, this is amazing. You won't say, just go. You, what's wrong with you? He said, listen, I'm good and my mercy endures forever. I'm good and my mercy endures forever. Woo! Then the king and all the people offered sacrifices before the Lord, and King Solomon offered a sacrifice. Listen to this now. You want to hear a sacrifice? Check this sacrifice out. 22,000 head of cattle, 120,000 sheep and goats. Woo, that was a bloody time. So the king and all the people dedicated the temple to God. When Solomon, you know why God loves Solomon? Because when God did something big, Solomon said, let me. He said, like they say in some Bible, I'm fixing. I'm fixing to do something big now. Because God did something big for me. He delivered me out of darkness. He brought me into the kingdom of God, the Son. He took me out of the clubs where I was thinking I was just shucking and jucking and looking around while my gig was on. He took me out of that place and he put a praise in my heart. He took me out of darkness and put me in light. He took me out of my mindsets and he renewed my mind and changed my mind about what I thought I wanted to do. Because I was always telling God, here's what I want to do. I'm not going to serve you because you're going to change my life. He said, yes, I am. But when are you going to lay it down? I'm coming after you, son. I'm coming after you. Your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Light and I'm coming after what's mine. The Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. Amen. Listen, God's got stuff for you to do. It's going to freak you out. It's going to lay freaks, say chic. It's going to freak you out. Listen, but Brother Johnson, back in my day, thunderstorms and lightning looks, man, he was stuff going down. Listen, those brothers could play. Huh? My first album, see, this is how I came up into this. My first album, my sister got me. It was Earth, Wind, and Fire, the White Album. You know, and it was like, shut up! You know how they do it? And they go with the bass, and then I was like, man, I was tripping out in my room. You know? It was like, can white boys dance or can white boys trip? I was tripping, you know? I was day tripping. Woo! But I was like, all of a sudden, man, I was just doing what I was doing. And all of a sudden, God was like, knock, knock, who's there? He's gone. I'm about to interrupt this special announcement to tell you, God is good. And his mercy endures forever. And I was like, and I was down sucking carpet. And I was going, Lord, I don't know if I can believe in all this. But I know what happened to me. See, the strongest thing that you have besides the Spirit of God and the Word of God is your testimony. You know why? It's yours. Nobody can take it from you. The people of faith used to say, you can't take it mine away. You know, you can, you know, however the first part of the line, when I can't remember. But he says, you know, it's yours. So my pastor used to say, not test the baloney, but test the testimonies. You know, listen, God can get your money, right? But if you serve him with your whole heart, I hear Matthew 6 for somebody. Matthew 6, if you seek me, you'll find me. If you seek me with your whole heart. You know, there's a lot of half-hearted seeking to try to get what you want, to try to get what I want. Well, it's common to man. And God said, if you'll seek me and put me first, I will give you the kingdom. He said, it's my good pleasure to give you. It's much more than money. I had to tell you. It's much more than money. Money can be a part of it, but if you're only asking for money, you're asking short. It's souls. It's souls. It's the kingdom business. If the king make haste, there was a lot of trouble and flax and stuff coming into this night. There was a lot of planning. There was a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. There was praying. There's a how we're going to do, but let's just say what the word says. Where is Prophet Michelle? I heard you. I hear you in here. There you are. Woo, there you are. There was a lot of travailing. There was a lot of believing. There was a lot of, we're going to keep our rudder straight. Keep saying what God is saying. You know, it's not fantasy when you say what God says. You are standing on the word that he's standing on. It'd be like me standing on this chair right here. Look, if I believe the chair is going to hold me, I'll stand on it. See, I did it. No hands, right? So you know I believe. Also, I know you believe because you hope I don't fall that way, right? So your faith was with me. I had agreement right here. When two or three are gathered together in my name, behold, I'm in the midst. Hey, you know, I got a crazy sense of humor. God gave it to me. I'm going to enjoy it. Hallelujah. If you're standing on the rock of your salvation, it is substance, not fluff. That's what I'm here to tell you. You can build anything God tells you to build as long as He's in it.
Amen.
Huh? Huh? I feel sassy with my priest right now. I feel like we're all sassy about it. Ah, I feel like coming after it. Ah, like chasing it down. See, there's a word where you come out of necessity that will come out of your belly where rivers of living water flow. Where you're not afraid to stand up and be bold about it like you used to be back in the day before you called yourself charismatic, Pentecostal, you know, bishop, apostle, prophet, whatever. You know, and some of you are, bless the Lord. Okay, thank God for that. But listen, before anybody gave you a title, you were a believer in Jesus Christ. And by His blood and by His body, you and I come in all the way. There's no other name under heaven where man can be saved. Amen?
Amen.
Tell me where I'm at, sir. 10 minutes? Okay. Amen. 10:15. Woo! All right, let's do this. Open your Bible. Look into the Word of God. Amos chapter... Where am I at? Amos, chapter 9. Amos 9:11. That's where it is. Amos 9. That's what the prophet Amos said. He talked about Israel's restoration. And this is where God is going. God is coming right in His timing. He's coming right in His purpose. You know, things are breaking out on one side. Matthew 24 says it. Luke 21 says it. Said that there's going to be, you know, earthquakes in diverse places, pestilences and things like that. People are going to say they're Jesus and all pots you do is look up in the hill, go out in the desert. He's out there. Don't believe it. Don't believe it. But Luke says this. He says, when you see all these things and all these troubles, it's a time of troubles. It's a time of stretching. It's a time where I'm bringing in the harvest of souls. He said, look up, your redemption draws nigh. You're now closer than when you first believed. In other words, there's joy in the morning. You know, listen, things come for a night that really test us. There is stuff you got to rebuke, and there's stuff you got to shoot, and there's stuff you got to resist, and there's stuff you got to just shut up and not say what you feel like saying in your emotion or in your flesh or whatever it is, and I do too. But when you get up in the thing and you know God put something, a word up in you, and you begin to declare, the Lord is my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is my light, whom shall I be afraid? The Lord will be standing up right with you, say, that's right, that's my boy, that's right, that's my girl, that's right, and you're worried about, you know, what you're going to do with these kids. Who are they going to go to school, and who's going to take care of them? Who's going to pick them up? And what if I can't count on this one? What if I can't count on Andy or Mama or this one or that one? You know? And God said, listen, you can count on me. I'm going to give you a strategy to raise your kids. I'm going to give you a strategy to have a better job. I'm going to give you a strategy to build my kingdom because the time is short. Look up. Your redemption draws nigh.
Amen.
I feel like preaching that right there. Ah! If I was in my house, I'd scream and run around. You know what I do in my house to clear the air? All the funky stuff. How many people, you know, all believe in Jesus, it's all good, then it gets funky. You know, it gets all funky up in your heart and say, hey, how did this get in here? I didn't let this in. Who let this stuff in? What kind of kids? Did you let your muddy shoes in, little kids? What'd get your muddy shoes off? Right? It's like that, but it's in the spirit. And you're not so mad that you're going to hurt somebody, but you want that funky stuff out. So that's what I do. I'm going to take it away from the mic when I do it. That's what I do. I go, let me tell you something, devil. I'm about to preach to you and declare to you the word of the Lord. That's what I do in my house. People, I have all these windows in my house. People must think, look at my window. There you go again. There he goes. See, we knew he was crazy. He knew he was all crazy. But listen, when they're in trouble, you know who they find? The crazy people. So people who are crazy enough to believe God. Amen? That's the people they look for. Crazy enough to do something. Oh, I'm going to get a new car. You ain't even got a job. You got no part-time job. You're taking care of three kids and your aunt's kids. You got a part-time job. You get a new car? Really? Really? I don't believe that. Really? Yeah, well, you're going to believe it when I pull up in the driveway with it. Huh? You're going to believe it when I move out this neighborhood and get in the better neighborhood where you are such a down in unbelief because I believe God. Huh? You get bold about your faith, God will be with you. God, I don't care how crazy and bold you get. If you get in it and you're in your spirit and faith, God will be with you.
That's right.
He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. Not now, not ever. I feel like preaching that right there. There's only one kind of devil, a lying devil. A devil going to lie to you. He's going to try to deceive you, give you something that kind of a little morsel that you might take, a little Jersey morsel, like, you know you don't have that toll money on a turnpike, so you're going to have to go back to Garden State or whatever. Like some little thing, and you're thinking, I don't got to listen to this junk. I'm gonna listen to this. What I get this stuff out. This is what I do. Jesus! That room clears like right now. Man, those devils run up out of there like, he is crazy. That man is a crazy bag. One of my sons called me. One of my sons, we were struggling. I got him. My two youngest ones are 98-99% in the nation, height and weight. Those boys are serious business, man. I fed them to get big. Now I got to fight them to hold them back. You know, we busted up couches. I've been to the chiropractor a bunch of times. And my chiropractor said, tell him to leave the old man alone. I said, who is that? I ain't no old man in this room. You want to be the old man? He's like 30. You be the old man, but I ain't no old man in this room. I ain't confessing that at all. He said, tell them to leave you alone. They're messing your back up. I said, well, listen, I got some stuff in here to come with. So as long as I got the engine on, baby, I'm coming with it. Now listen, my second son is 6'5". With his boots on, he's 6'7". Wow. Marine Corps, top 1%, 2% in the nation. Wow. All right? My oldest son, Department of Defense, 7 tours over in the Middle East, okay? Listen, they said, you know I can make it? Yes, I trained you. I trained you to obey God. I trained you in godliness and righteousness. I ain't perfect, but Jesus is. Yes. And I trained you with what works, and that's Him. It's teaching and training. It's not, see, they get on the same page. You don't think you're perfect. You don't apologize. Like, I think you should. Really? When you grow up, you tell that to me. I'll be an old man by then. You'd be raising your own kids. They'd be kicking your butt. Huh? They'd be running you around the place ragged. You'd be exhausted working 2-3 jobs if you don't get this stuff straightened out. Huh? Tell the truth, somebody. Huh? Tell them the truth when they don't want to hear it. Tell them the truth because you love them enough. That their life would matter, that it means something.
Amen.
That you love them enough to bring them up right and train them in godliness. Listen, the old men and women of faith knew this. It was like generational. And man, if you were laying in the pew falling asleep, they'd grab you by the scruff of your neck and tuck you up.
That's right.
You know? You'd go 3-4-5 hour meeting. They drag you up to the altar at the end. Like, I think you were sleeping. I think you need some Jesus. And you couldn't sue them back in that day. They could drag your butt up there, do all kinds of stuff, and go home happy. Huh? We need some of that today. There's a fear of God in the house. If there's a fear of God in the house, there's peace in the house.
Amen.
You know, the devil is a liar. Listen, and he said, you super of power. He's always demanding stuff. Always, you got to do this and you got to do that. You know you want to do this. He's going on and on and on about it. But not the Lord. The Lord said, I set you at liberty. I'm a good God. And I'm bringing you into a place that you never imagined. Trust me. He keep provoking us to trust Him. Amen.
Amen.
Where am I at? Amos chapter 9. In that day I will restore David's fallen tent. I will repair its broken places, restore its ruins. I will build it as it used to be, so that they may possess the remnant of Eden. And all the nations that bear my name, declares the Lord, who will do these things. The days are coming, declares the Lord, that when the reaper will overtake the plowman, and the planter the one who is treading grapes. New wine will drip from the mountains and flow from the hills. I will bring back my exiled people Israel, and they will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them. It's like Isaiah 61, 58, 59, 60, 61. They're going to rebuild it. And that will plant vineyards and drink their wine, and they will make gardens and eat their fruit. God is in the building business. You always want to figure out if your discernment's not working, the batteries are out. Want to figure out who's in God's side? God's in the building business. He builds people's hearts up. He restores past the dwelling. He heals your brokenhearted. He set the captive free. He's in the building business. The devil's in the tearing down business. Strife and contention and every evil work. You know, fornication and anger. You know, the 7 deadly sins, all that kind of stuff. He's in the tearing down the lion business. God will tell you the truth, and then He'll build you up. He said, I love you enough, and I put my affection upon you, and I'm building your life. Trust me. Trust me. Trust me. That's what He'll do. Amen. I feel like exhorting the body of Christ and the fivefold ministry tonight. Amen. Let's turn real quick to Luke 21. I'm wrapping up here. Let's look at verse 10, where it speaks about these things. Nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. This is Luke 21:10. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilence in various and diverse places, and fearful events and great signs from the heaven. And before all this, they will lay hands on you and persecute you and deliver you into synagogues and prisons, and brought before kings and governors, and on account of my name, this will result in you being witnesses to them. Did you catch that?
Yes.
If you're witnessing to Jesus, let me just give you some really good news. You're going to be persecuted. But listen to this.
Yeah.
With that persecution comes exaltation. You know, the Lord will say, you're mine, because you weren't ashamed of me, and I am not ashamed of you. That's worth it. That's worth it. Let them think what they want. Let God be true and every man be a liar. Glory to God. It says, but make up your mind not to worry beforehand. This is what it says in 14. It's right there. Luke 21:14. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how to defend yourselves, for I'll give you the words and wisdoms, and none of you, your adversaries, will be able to resist or contradict you. You will be betrayed even by parents, brothers, and friends, and they will put some of you to death. All men will hate you because of me, but not a hair of your head will perish. By standing firm, you will gain life. When you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, you will know that the desolation or the day of desolation is near. And let those who in Judea flee to the mountains, those in the city get out, and those in the country enter into the city. For this is the time of the punishment and the fulfillment that has been written, when the day of God's reward and also the day of God's judgment. How dreadful it will be in those days for pregnant women nursing mothers. There will be great distress in the land and wrath against the people. They will fall down by the sword and be taken prisoners into all nations. You just can't believe what you see in the news today. You just can't believe, like, really? Really, is it happening? Are they tapping with that? Is that really happening? It's really happening. But he says, when you see the great distress in the land, then it says there will be, all nations will gather together, and Jerusalem will be trampled down by the Gentiles, where we are now, until the end times are fulfilled of the Gentiles. Then there will be signs of the sun, the moon, the stars, and on the earth the nations will anguish and perplexity, roaring and tossing the sea. Men will faint with terror and apprehensive of what's coming in the world, for the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, they will see this, and look at this. All this news, it seemed like it's getting worse and worse. Then he says, at that time, you will see the Son of Man coming in the cloud with great power and great glory. Amen? Amen. When these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads, because your redemption draws near. Yeah. He's saying, hey, look, it's going to happen. You can rebuke it. You know, all that stuff. You can pray protection over your family. You should. But listen, God said it's going to happen like this. But he said, when you see it, the Son of Man is coming.
Yes.
He said, so look up in great glory and great power. No wimpy stuff. He's going to have himself a bride that's without spot, wrinkle, or blemish.
Amen.
He's purifying that bride even now. Some of it happens through persecution. Some of it happens through trouble. Part of our problem here in America is we've had it too easy too long. We've had high days and some of what we think are low days, but we've never had some bad days. You know? Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Give me a little worship on the keyboard right there, would you, brother? Give me a little worship. Amen. Let's worship the Lord for a minute. Just flowing the Holy Ghost here. Amen. Amen. Father, we give you praise. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we give you all the honor, all the glory, all the praise. It's all yours. In Ezekiel 40, you said to Ezekiel, shall these bones live? These dry bones, these broken bones, these bones who have fallen apart and are as if dead. And in verse 3, he said, Lord, you know. And he simply said to him, prophesy to those bones. Speak life into those bones. Speak life into those bones and say, live. You will come together. You will be alive. You will have sinews on you. You will have flesh on you again. You will stand up inside yourself and be who you were meant to be and who you were designed to be. You will not lay there and just take it. You will not lay there and just endure it. You will come together. He said, look at Israel's my timepiece. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Psalm 122. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem, those who prosper, who love it. You want to see God's timepiece? It's Jerusalem. It's Israel. It's his people. When you see these things going on, understand I'm drawing near. How about you and me? Galatians 3 says, we are grafted in. You know, if you be the seed of Abraham, you are heirs with a promise. Heirs with a promise. If you're a Gentile, you come in the bloodline of Jesus as an heir of the promise, and you believe in him.